Good morning. We just want to welcome you to Kensington Church this morning to celebrate Easter with us, to celebrate resurrection with us. We're going to get started in 2 to 3 minutes, but I just wanted to pop in and say hi to you and welcome you and just let you know how grateful we are to have you join us. It's going to be a beautiful day, a lot of beautiful music, and we're going to dive into a passage, a story from Luke 24 that is really intriguing to us. So we invite you to just take that journey with us. So stick with us. We're going to be back up in a little bit, and we'll see you soon. Well, welcome. How's everybody doing? You know, attending my grandpa's church when I was a little kid, I learned something. It was this Easter interaction some of us are familiar with, some of us aren't. So maybe some of you know it. If I say this, then you respond. So I'm going to say, he is risen. Okay, all right. Man, happy Easter. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you so much for celebrating resurrection with us. And we have a beautiful service planned with music and just storytelling. And we're going to look at a passage from Luke 24 that we're really excited about that just relates to us in so many ways. And we're just going to invite you to just experience that with us. A couple things that I do want to share. As you were walking in, you probably got a piece of paper. If you're new or newer to this place, to our church, our community here, this just kind of shares like who we are, what we're about. We are a church definitely that cares about getting outside of the walls of a building and making an impact in the community, making an impact globally. And so that just kind of explains what we do, what our heartbeat is, and even how you can get involved if that's something that you want to do. The other thing is John in here? John Cargill. Oh, he's in the back. Well, hey, can somebody hand me this right here? Next question is, thanks, Ron. Do we have any junior hires or high school students in the room? If that's you, can you just stand up for a second? Like, can we give them a hand for being here? So here's the deal. part of today is just kind of a fun thing, but if you text this number, my man John back here wants to give this away. So it's a Nintendo Switch. So if you're a junior high student or a high school student, my son Jude was dying this morning because he's like, I'm in fifth grade. I want a Switch. Sorry, buddy, next year. But no, text this number. Text your first and last name to this number, and then we're going to take everybody's names and just do a little random giveaway later this afternoon. So if you would do that, that'd be amazing. Listen, as we dive in this morning, we've been doing a series called 12 Hours. We've been looking at the last 12 hours of Jesus' life and everything that he went through and how the kingdoms of the world just kind of came against him. And Friday, we looked at this gruesome journey that Jesus went on. It's a funeral. It was somber. It was sad. And so we're going to begin with that tone this morning and tell the story a little bit and just invite you to watch this.
My fellow Pharisees and I observed Jesus carefully, and it became clear that we could no longer dismiss these miracles as rumors. He did heal people. He claimed to be the Son of God. Blasphemous, punishable by death. And that is what we had planned.
Jesus carried his heavy cross, step by step, toward the hill where he would spend his final hours and take his last breath.
It's never personal.
Never make it personal.
But after a while, it turns into a job. Some people are farmers, some are craftsmen, some people are politicians or philosophers. I'm a centurion, 873 executions. It was the 874th that changed everything. After a few hours had passed, something strange happened. It started to get dark. You know, I thought a storm was coming, but it wasn't. And then I heard 874 say something.
Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing.
I slowly looked up at the prisoner, and our eyes met. I couldn't look away. Who is this man? How could he say these things? When 874 gave up his last breath, the sky became like night, but it was only 3 in the afternoon. Suddenly, the earth began to shake more and more violently. People started running away, the noise, the confusion. When the quake finally ended, I looked at the prisoner, lifeless on the cross. He was dead.
But they've killed him, Jesus. They crucified him like a blasphemous lunatic. Pharisees stood by, spitting on him, insulting him. He did not deserve this.
There was a moment when the lights went out, when death had claimed its victory. The King of Love had given up his life, the darkest day in history. There on the cross they made for sin, for every curse his blood atoned. One final breath and it is finished, but not the end we could have known.
I cannot sleep. I lay there staring into suffocating, oppressive darkness. And just when I start to drift away, I hear his voice. It's soft and barely audible, but it's him. His voice, distant, calling my name. Mary. I sense this sorrow leaving my body, this hope stirring in my soul, but when I open my eyes, there's only darkness. So in desperation, I run outside. I must find him before he leaves, but he's not there. And I'm alone. He's gone. His voice, it's silent. I've dreamt of him calling to me. It's maddening. I'm torturing myself. I mean, he's gone. He's dead. You saw it with your own two eyes, the cross, the nails, the limp body. I miss him. I miss his voice, the voice of the one who healed me. Last night, Mary and Salome and I went to the market to buy myrrh and aloe for his body. I didn't want to go. I wanted to just curl up in a dark corner and never face the world again. But because she is mourning her beloved son, I will go everywhere with her. I mean, who else is gonna do it? Matthew, John, Peter, and Thomas, and all the others are in hiding. I get that they fear for their life, but why protect a life without him? But Jesus spoke full of life now, and eternal life with him in heaven. But how can we now hope for either?
There was a moment when the sky lit up. A flash of light breaking through. When all was lost, he crossed eternity. The King of Life was on the
before dawn now, and we're near the tomb. I wonder what we'll see. We've been walking at a fast pace with our heads down, but I just keep thinking over and over about a mysterious thing Jesus said. He said he'd be delivered into the hands of men, suffered a great deal, and killed. And that is what happened. But then he said this: on the third day, I will be raised. We all thought there was a hidden meaning, or perhaps he was warning or preparing us. Or could he have meant that he would, or somehow he would, I can't go there again. What is happening? Where's the stone? Who is that? Mary, do you see what I'm seeing?
Let's all stand together.
Do you see what I see? Do you see what I see? Oh, I see lightning, I hear thunder. Something stirring 6 feet under. Back to life again. I believe that's about to be enough.
church, I need you to get excited this morning. He's alive. Come on.
Continue with the morning and the celebration.
And there on a tree, the Lamb of God was crucified. grave I'm walking to. If you walked out of the grave I'm walking to. If you walked out of the grave I'm walking to. Oh, yeah. If you walked out of the grave I'm walking to. Oh.
Each day we're moving, step by step, toward a destination or wandering aimlessly. Whether we're stepping in sandals across deserts of hot sand or clicking heels down polished halls, we're all on a journey. Some of us have places to go. When the end point is in sight, we're propelled with purpose and our tired feet pick up momentum. Some of us have journeys with a hairpin turn. We're going one way, full of dreams. And something shatters them. In an instant, we spin around and rush in the exact opposite direction to put increased distance between us and the past. Some of us can't see our destination. We're not sure where we're going. Our steps are erratic and hesitant. We may tread in circles, dizzy and discouraged. Is there hope on this road we stumble down?
Can we just give our worship team like a hand for leading us in that? Over and over, it's like they lead us in story. They lead us in worship. They just lead us so well, and I'm just so grateful, man. I was in the back like jumping around, trying to avoid being seen. And man, can we try this again? He is risen. Yeah. That was better than the first time. We're learning. Again, it's beautiful to celebrate resurrection with you. And thank you so much for being here. And man, it's a personal day. It's a corporate day. And it's precious to me. It's precious to a lot of people around here. And I hope in the deepest way it's precious to you too. Before I dive in, I want to just share. There's a couple ways to give for those of you that give around here. You can check out these ways. You can text. There's a website. There's an app. There's wooden boxes in the back. And listen, I go back to what I said earlier. The piece of paper that you got when you walked in here, it just shares who we are as a church, what we're about. And so many people serve and give toward that mission and in that movement. And so many of us give financially as an act, as a response of worship. And so there's different ways that you can give. And just thank you. Thank you for supporting us. All the things that you see happening on that list can't be done without your partnership. So when Jesus showed up on the scene, the people were just tired. The Roman government, the Roman Empire, the Roman kingdom was just oppressing them. They were occupying their territory, their land, and the people were just tired of it. And then on top of that, you had a corrupt religious system that became toxic. It was broken. And so people were tired of these two kingdoms that were constantly oppressing them. And so when Jesus shows up and he's talking about, you know, there's word that he's a king and that there's a kingdom involved. And when he rides into the city, into Jerusalem on a donkey, they were going nuts. Palm branches on the ground, they're shouting, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Save us. They're calling him the King of Israel. But I wonder what happened. In 5 days, something shifted, didn't it? They went from screaming, save us, to crucify him. Now, I want you to imagine if you're a disciple, a follower of Jesus, and maybe you left your family, your career, maybe following Jesus meant you're going in a completely different trajectory because you think that there's something about Jesus that can fix the religious system, the religious kingdom, and there's something about Jesus that can free them from Roman oppression. And I just think about the disappointment. But we fast forward 3 days to the morning of resurrection, and there's so many, I'm telling you, there are so many incredible messages being given right now in so many churches. But I want to focus on one of the first things that Jesus did on the day he was resurrected. We know that Jesus' 11 remaining disciples, they were off in hiding. They were freaked out because they didn't want what happened to Jesus to happen to them. And then others who were followers of Jesus, like, they were just disappointed. Like, for years, maybe they followed Jesus, and then all of a sudden it comes to a halt. He's buried. He's in the ground. Like, can you imagine the whiplash? I just want to say this. Today's message is for you. If you've ever been in a season where your hopes, your dreams, your expectations were crushed. I know I've been in a season like that. I've been in a season where I thought that maybe it was easier to not hope again than to have hope and be disappointed again. And so Jesus' death, the people are disappointed, and I mean, like, Jesus gave them hope in the first place. He shows up on the scene. He gave them initial hope, but then they piled expectations onto the hope that Jesus gave them, and now they're disappointed. Their hearts are crushed. I mean, I wonder if hope was just sucked right out of their hearts. I'm fascinated by this dilemma. I mean, Jesus told them, he said this, he said on three different occasions, he said, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests and the teachers of the law. He must be killed and on the third day raised to life. Like, wouldn't you think they'd be expecting this? Like, Jesus kept saying this. Don't you think they would have been at the tomb, the entrance to the tomb, ready to throw like a resurrection welcome out of the grave party? But instead, it didn't go that way. Instead, it actually went just how Jesus said it was going to go. Jesus said, and he was quoting Zechariah, he said, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. Scattered. Easter morning, resurrection morning, this is where we find the disciples. They are scattering because their shepherd has been struck. And I want to look at a story of two of them. It's actually found in Luke 24. There's two disciples that are in the midst of scattering. Their hearts are filled with disappointment, grief. Like, they believed in Jesus, but did they misjudge him? And now they're walking away. Their backs are actually turned to Jesus, and they're walking away from Jesus. And they're walking to Emmaus. Some of you might know the story, the disciples walking to Emmaus. Emmaus is like 7 miles away from Jerusalem, so they're walking back, and they're discussing everything that's going on. They're probably talking, but like, how did this happen? We thought he was a king. We thought there was a kingdom. How did this happen? And then this stranger shows up, and this is what's fascinating about the story. A stranger shows up, and it's actually Jesus, resurrected Jesus, but they don't recognize him. And so in the midst of their conversation, this is what it says. One of them, named Cleopas, replies. Jesus asks the question, like, what are you guys talking about? Again, they don't know it's Jesus. And he replies, are you the only one visiting Jerusalem that does not know the things that have happened there in these days? Like, are you the only person that hasn't heard what happened? And Jesus says, again, they can't recognize him. What things? About Jesus of Nazareth, they replied. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and the rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one that was going to redeem Israel. Notice what they said. They had hoped. You feel it? They had all these kinds of hopes and expectations for Jesus. He was going to reform the religious system. He was going to free them from the power of Rome. They were going to be a free and independent people with a reformed, a beautiful religion again. And now he's dead in a grave. And they're walking away, and in their mouths they have this phrase, we had hoped. Listen, sometimes we hope for things so much smaller than what God wants for us. Like sometimes we think we're hoping for something really big. We think it's really big. And when it doesn't work out, we lose hope or we wonder what happened. But maybe God has something bigger in mind. Maybe we even walk away. Let me ask you this, because I want this to be also personal. I want to relate with these two disciples that have been disappointed. Have you ever hoped for something so much that you built up expectations in your head? Maybe you had certain hopes for your life or your career. Maybe you hoped a relationship would work out. Maybe you had hope sucked from your heart because of a trauma or a hardship you've been through. Many of us have experienced a level of pain that has made hope seem foreign to us. Or maybe God didn't work in your life like you expected. Can I ask this? What is it for you? What is something that you hoped for that didn't work out? Can you put it in one word in your head? What's that one word? Something that you hoped for that didn't work out. I think this, I mean, I'm processing this week and just relating with these disciples, and it reminds me of the proverb. Like, this is what they were feeling. Hope deferred makes a heart sick. And this is what's going on. It's true, and this is what's going on with the disciples as they're walking away from Jesus, going back to whatever life they had before. Hope was deferred, and they had sick hearts. And they go on to explain to Jesus, like, well, the women ran to the grave, and they didn't find anyone in the grave, and they saw a vision of an angel that said he had risen, and then someone else confirmed that. Like, all this, it's happening, but they're so blinded by their expectations. It's crazy to me. Like, we can be so blinded by what isn't taking place that we can't actually see what is taking place. Our misplaced expectations can blind us to the work of God in our lives and in the world. And maybe for them, Jesus' his death was so graphic that they couldn't imagine him coming back from that. And so again, Jesus, he's unrecognized. They're walking with him on the road to Emmaus. He actually opens up the scripture, starts explaining things to them. And he's explaining what's written about the Messiah. And they get to Emmaus, and they're offering hospitality to Jesus, and they invite Jesus to come and have dinner. So they go and have dinner, and then here's the scene. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, he gave thanks, he broke it and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him because they had been in this scene before. And then Jesus disappeared from their sight and they asked each other, like, weren't our hearts burning when he talked with us on the road, opening up the scriptures? To me, this story is so crazy. Like, for one, like, why couldn't they recognize Jesus? The other thing is, like, what did Jesus say? Because I want to preach that sermon. The other thing is, what was it about Jesus breaking the bread that made them recognize him? And then why did he disappear? There's all kinds of questions. But this story, this interaction between Jesus and the his followers who are walking away, it reveals something to us about the heart of God. What's one of the most important things, one of the first things that the resurrected Christ did? What's one of his top priorities? What does the resurrected Christ do? Maybe you need to hear this. Jesus pursues you when you're walking away. Jesus is in pursuit of you as you're walking away. For the disciples, they turned their back on him. They lost hope. They were disappointed, and they were walking in the other direction, the wrong direction. And Jesus pursues them as they're walking away. And maybe something's going on in your life. Maybe your life is filled with depression. Maybe you're walking away. Maybe you're experiencing some kind of despair or disappointment. Maybe, like the disciples, maybe you don't always listen like you should. Maybe you're walking away from Jesus. Maybe you're thinking about throwing in the towel. Maybe you've thrown in the towel. You just need to know that Jesus is pursuing you. The resurrected Christ is in pursuit of you. Jesus sees us. He goes after us. We matter to Jesus. You matter to Jesus. What doesn't matter to Jesus is the direction you're walking in, because he's going after you anyways. I love that about him. The second thing that this story shows us is that Jesus makes himself close to you before he reveals himself to you. The disciples, man, they're walking and they don't even know it's him. They don't even recognize it's him, but Jesus is working in their life. Jesus is there, he's working. It's only till later that they recognize it was him all along. You ever have this happen? It's like life happens and you didn't know it at the time, but God was working in your life. And then time goes by and then you look back and you say, oh my gosh, that was him working in my life, in my heart the whole time. You don't even have to be walking in the right direction. He comes close to you. It's the promise of Scripture. God is with you. Jesus, the resurrected Christ, the risen Jesus is close to you. And maybe this is just a promise that you need to hear. Maybe you just need to hear this, that he's near to you, that he's pursuing you. Like, he's in your life even if you don't recognize it. He's in your life if you don't feel it. He is working. He's working all around you. And I love that about him. Another thing we see from this story is that Jesus doesn't reject your lack of faith. He works to reshape your faith. The disciples, they're walking back. They kind of gave up. Like, death conquered, right? Like, took Jesus out. Like, they've given up. They've lost hope. They don't have faith in Jesus anymore. And he shows up and he works to reshape their faith. Maybe he's reshaping your faith by working in your heart. Maybe he's placed people in your life and he's working to reshape your faith. I don't know what this looks like. But guess what? Jesus is not afraid of your skepticism, your cynicism, your negativity. He doesn't shy away from it. He actually enters into it to reshape and reframe your faith. Jesus is reshaping your faith. And guess what? I love that about him. Don't you? Another thing is Jesus, he brings fresh hope to your disappointment. Like he's the one that gives us hope in the first place. And then you start to follow him, and maybe like the disciples, maybe like me, you build up expectations or what you think this is supposed to look like, and then all of a sudden it doesn't look like you expected. And then you're left in despair and disappointment, frustration. And then Jesus shows up again, and he offers fresh hope. I love what Paul wrote to a church about the way God works. Paul said, "May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us by his grace, gave us eternal encouragement and good hope. May he encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word." This is God's heart, to encourage you, to strengthen you, to give you good hope, fresh hope. And guess what? Can you say it with me? I love that about him. Another thing I'd want to share is that, and this is important, Jesus isn't just our Savior. He's your Savior. Now, don't get me wrong. What I'm saying is, before he can be our Savior, he has to be your Savior. This has to be true on a personal level before it can be true on a collective level. Jesus died for me. Can you just say that in your head? Say that in your heart. Jesus died for me. Because before this can be true collectively, it has to be true personally. And like this is the gift of Easter that we receive, that we come together, we celebrate this, but don't let Easter, don't let resurrection pass you by without responding personally. Jesus died for me. He died for you. He's your Savior. So the story goes on with these disciples. Like, they're freaked out. Jesus showed up. They just recognized him. They run back 7 miles to meet up with the other 11 disciples, the actual disciples, and they show up, and they're like freaking out. Could you just imagine the scene? It's like they had 14 Red Bull energy drinks. It's like, we saw him. We saw Jesus. He's alive. Like, they can't even catch their breath. They're stuttering like me. Like, it's just ridiculous. And then all of a sudden, Jesus shows up to the hole, to all of them. And they freak out. They think he's a ghost. And he's like, "Why are you troubled?" And he shows them. He shows them his hands and his feet. Look, ghosts don't have wounds. Touch them. Touch my wounds. And then Jesus, kind of silly in the story, but he's like, "Hey, I'm hungry." Like, after everything Jesus went through, could you just imagine the appetite? Like, can I eat now? Is there any places open nearby? Chick-fil-A's right around the corner. The line's like a half a mile long, though. What does he order? What does he order? Broiled fish. It's true. Like, they give him broiled fish. But then he says some things that are really important. He says, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. It's like everything had to happen. All this stuff that we just experienced together, it had to happen because we had to fulfill everything that was written by Moses and the prophets and the Psalms. And then it goes on and it says that he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. I love that. I don't know what all that entails, but I love he opens their minds so they can understand the scriptures. And he told them, this is what was written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead and on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations. Say that again. Repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are a witness to these things. I'm going to send you what my Father promised. We know now that's the Holy Spirit. So stay in the city until you've been clothed with power from on high. Here's the deal about repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Repentance for the forgiveness of sins is a gift to receive personally. This is something that Easter, that resurrection offers, that we receive. Easter is a gift to be received personally, and it is repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And so let's not just talk about Christ as our Savior. Let's first talk about Christ as your Savior, as my Savior. Are you with me? I'm grateful that he overcame the grave. I'm grateful that the power of sin and death has no hold on Jesus. I mean, what we celebrate today, what we celebrate resurrection, it's this idea that Jesus overcame sin and death. He overcame my sin, my dysfunction, my brokenness. And that's why we go nuts on Easter. And listen, if you're here and you've received this personally, you know what I'm talking about. But maybe your family drug you here. Maybe you're here out of obligation, sitting through another service with a floral shirt on. You know, it's the Easter thing. Make it personal. Easter 2022, make it personal. Just say this in your heart. If you're here and you just want to make Easter personal, be my Savior, Jesus. Be my Savior. I know there's obligations. I know you're probably going to a nice brunch after this and all this stuff, family stuff's happening. But make this Easter personal. Be my Savior, Jesus. Can I just do something crazy? If you prayed that, if you said that in your heart, and you said it for the first time and you mean it, would you stand up? Would there be anybody here that would stand up and say, I'm making Easter personal this year? Would anybody stand up? You know what we need to do then? We need to pray for the second service. We need to pray that Jesus stirs in somebody's heart in the second service. That somebody's drug here for Easter, going through the motions, this obligatory thing, that somebody makes Easter personal this year. I want to end with a poem. I go to bed early on Saturday nights, especially when we have two services, because I wake up at like, you know, just early. So I go to bed early. And somebody thought, hey, let's text Joel at midnight. No, I asked this person too. I was razzing on him this morning. But he sent me a poem that I just love to close on. A perfectly designed plan revealed through God's creation. A perfectly designed man revealed for our salvation. A perfectly designed repair was given, revealed by Jesus when he was risen. A perfectly designed gift of love revealed by our Father above. God's mercy and grace give us reason for faith and hope in every season. Isn't that beautiful? Pray with me. Lord, we praise you. We love you. We love that you come to us in the midst of our disappointment, in our chaos, when our backs are turned to you, when things don't work out how we want. Lord, we praise you for chasing us down and pursuing us and causing our hearts to burn. Lord, I pray today that we would leave this place as just making it personal or just being reminded that it is personal. And Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit is working this morning on all of our hearts and the hearts of those that are coming to the 11 o'clock, that somebody would make it personal for the first time. Lord, you are good. And so, Lord, as we sing these songs and as we praise you, be near. And we know that you are. In Jesus' name, amen.
Why don't you go ahead and stand with us for this ending set?
You alone deserve the glory. cross was crowned with thorns, is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at his feet we bow.
His final breath upon the
Celebrating Easter, for celebrating resurrection with us today. I just hope you have a great day, a great celebration. Listen, if you're somebody who, you know, you didn't stand up when we asked you to stand up because you wanted to make it personal and it was weird to stand up, I would just encourage you. I'd love to talk to you. Our prayer team would love to talk to you if you want to make this Easter, if you want to make it personal. Our prayer team will be up here after the service. I would just love to invite you. If not, if you've already made it personal, man, have a great day. Thank you guys so much for being here. Take care.